Zeit. Das war Deutsch. Es gibt Momente im Leben.
There are moments in the life of a moderator. To be thankful for the audience that is still left, and that is, I think, one of these moments. So very happy that you are still here. Hours progressed, I know, but we promise you this is going to be a very, very exciting panel. This is going to be so exciting that you want to stay here overnight. Now, we thought we don't want to be in these theoretical discussions, populism, and how can we defend our freedom. So more of an abstract discussion. Now let's break it down to the institutional level. Now, with this panel, we're trying to get where Mr. Moravcik believed is the most boring about the European debate. Now, but let's try to face the challenge and ask. Now, how can we, in concrete terms, change the House of Europe? How do we need to change it, and that it is capable of addressing people, getting people on board, so to speak, including those that are sitting here. Now, we have a couple of suggestions that our President of the Commission has tabled, in that unfamous white paper of the European Commission. I will not ask for a show of hands who has not read this white paper. Nonetheless, we're not in school here, but nonetheless, I would like to explain them to you. Scenario one is continue the way we've always done. So a new state for Europe, which was concluded by the 27 member states at the Bratislava Declaration. So continue. Scenario number two, focus single market. Well, the 27 remaining EU members are to agree on expanding the single market and concentrate on that only, and that would then be the institutional core of that European Union of the future. Scenario three, one counts a little bit on and advocates voluntarism is like an optional program based on international law, supplementing European law. So everything remains the way it's been, but some states are allowed among themselves to do kind of like bilateral stuff, coalition of the willing, so to speak, and can do more because the other member states want to follow suit. Scenario four, less but more efficient, which is the EU of various different speeds, the way I see it, in selected areas. There is a fast lane, so to speak, and when there will be the main resources allocated. And scenario number five means more action. Member states resolve to share more competences on the EU level. Decisions are made faster and implemented faster. So that's one of the extreme, so to speak, scenarios of deepening the EU. So that is what that's the white paper. Well, that's what the Commission presented. And we looking at it, at the face of it, we find that it is nothing new. Nothing is decided. It's just simple listing of options. I would like to ask the first panelist, which is Shada Islam, to the left of me. She is director of policy at the Friends of Europe. She is headquartered in Brussels, so not too far away from the Commission that has put on the table this white paper. She is, by the way, responsible for Europe's future, but also questions of integration and minorities in Europe, and and also in foreign policy and development policy, she has been very effective. And she was a European correspondent for the Eastern Economic Review, a newspaper or a magazine. And to you, the question. This white paper that's been presented, boring? Not surprising? What do we do with it? What can we do with it? What the best thing we can do with it?
Ondřej, Sergey, that's a great way to start. So good evening, everyone, and I'm glad there's still people in this room. Thank you for your patience and for being here. Look, I would have liked it to be a bolder, more courageous move. I cannot imagine President Xi Jinping of China or Russia's Putin going to the assembly and coming out with five options. You know, he would go out there and say, this is it, guys. You follow me. This is the way to the future. But we live in a democracy, and this is not Juncker's style, and this is not the style of the European Commission. So, as you said, you know, we're just a heartbeat away from the European Commission. And, you know, with other people here, including my colleague from SEPS, we follow everything on a very, very, very closely. And I have to say, for me, I thought this was quite not boring. This was quite an interesting development. I disagreed with Andrew this morning, who said the European Union following it in detail is boring. I have to say I've never been bored. I've been following it for 30 years now, as a journalist before and now as an analyst. I think Europe is fun. And Europe has considerable achievements that maybe all of you do not recognize, but I was born outside Europe. I'm an accidental European, I'm a committed European, but I recognize all the successes and achievements of this entity, the things that we have achieved. So to come back to Juncker, so this is not Juncker's style. I mean, you know, he's from Luxembourg, and you know, he's a calm guy. He's got certain problems, as you all know, but you know, he's got five pathways, and really in the end it's only one and a half, it's three and a half, right? So what I think is quite interesting in this 21st century, faced with these challenges, he's had the courage to come out and say, look, we need to be flexible, we need to be agile, we need to be nimble, we need to react quickly to changes that are happening around us. And if we wait for the laggards, for the slow people out there to join us for each and every step we take, we'll never make it. We'll be completely overtaken by other countries and events. So the multi-speed, I know it's, people say, guys, it's been there for a very long time. This is what Europe does, you know, Schengen, Eurozone, every other thing. But when they go to Rome for the 60th anniversary, and they actually sit down and bring out a declaration, and they actually come out and say, this is one option, this is something that's going to be in that declaration, I think it means a lot. And I think, Sergey, it will really save Europe, the kind of Europe we want, the kind of Europe that is modern, up-to-date, and able to meet all the different challenges we face, including the challenge of Brexit. Now, what's going to happen in Rome is a new EU is going to be born, right? This is something that's going to happen. EU of 27 will be born in Rome. That's what we're going to have to deal with in the future. And I think this is an important moment for us to redefine ourselves. Who is European? What is Europe? And are we going to be overtaken by events, including populism that we talked about earlier this morning or this afternoon, or are we going to set our own agenda? And I think a multi-speed Europe is going to be able to take up the challenges much more than if we waited for everyone to join the ranks. Now, what are the... Just to say a little bit about Rome, I think, you know, we always talked about leadership as well, and everyone says, you know, we need the good leaders, we need the visionary leaders. You know, those leaders are here among us. Everyone this morning was talking about Mark Rutte in the Netherlands. You know, I was so amazed, no one mentioned Jesse Klaver. I mean, Jesse Klaver is an amazing person. The fact that a man like him, 30 years old, of Moroccan descent, so not the scum that Geert Wilders was talking about, but actually from that community, half Indonesian, he rises to the top of the Green Links party. I think this is the Europe that we want to celebrate today. Why do we focus on all the Geert Wilders of this world? Marine Le Pen, why are we always, and Madame Cécile, you said this morning, why are we focused on Marine Le Pen only? There is other people out there. There are other people. So I think these are the kinds of things we have to look at. As I said to you, I look at Europe with slightly different eyes. I see a Europe that is flourishing with major, major problems. But guys, who doesn't have them? China doesn't have problems. India doesn't have problems. Russia doesn't have problems, and not to mention the United States. So I think European leaders should go to Rome with their heads held high, recognizing our achievements, but also aware that there are many, many challenges that still lie ahead. For me, dealing with the refugee crisis and our minorities, Europe is full of minorities, not national minorities, but ethnic minorities, religious minorities. Let's bring them into the discussion as well. We are full of cities. Our cities are so vibrant and dynamic. Let's bring them into the conversation as well. Let's bring the young people in. So that's why when I saw what Alexander Freiherr's movement, Pulse Europe, the emotion that is there, this is what is important. So Juncker, you know, the white paper, I think, will trigger a discussion. And yes, there'll be summit conclusions and summit declarations and all that. But what really matters is, I think, he's setting an agenda for the future. And it's up to us as European citizens to take that agenda forward through streets, through town hall discussions, all those different things. And with the European Parliament elections coming up in 2019, I think this is the moment when the people, as Alexander said, the people have to actually take up the challenge and say why they think Europe is important. Thank you, Sergey.
Wow, das war sehr motivierend. Ich hoffe,
rather motivating. I hope that you still stay in this room and not take to the street right away, but only after the panel. But now, this momentum, this emotion, this passion, this passionate plea for a Europe of the different speeds, want to make it double check with the reality of the parliamentary routine work. Ska Keller is chair of the Green Group. Eva, as well. Eva. And she is also integration policy spokesperson of the faction for many, many years. So also these issues are on the agenda. And I ask you, as a green politician, as one of the youngest and most interesting in the faction, and by the way, and also, yeah, this panel is composed exclusively of people that were born outside the EU. I hope I haven't got your age wrong, but all of us that are sitting here were not born in EU member states at the time they were born. So it's not just Shada, the privilege here. So the same holds true for Ska. Now we've got these five options. Now you, maybe not now, but one day you will be speaking on behalf of the faction or which stand for the vision of the Green Party for Europe. What's your impression that Europe of different speed, is that the model which best reflects this new, this vivid, this vibrant Europe without countries which are faster and those which are left behind? Is that the model?
No idea which language to speak, so I'm starting with English. Well, classically, when we're asked about which of the five scenarios of Juncker we would prefer, we say we take the sixth, because we're really not happy with this scenario paper. And well, first of all, I think it's not maybe a sign of strength that five scenarios are being presented, but I can still, you know, buy that. I see the problems that we have in reality, that if Juncker would present one, then for sure everyone would hate that option and we would end up nowhere. So I'm fine with that. But what I'm really troubled by is that all these scenarios are purely institutional. It doesn't say okay, we have to change the policies of the European Union to bring it closer to the citizens, we have to change direction, whatever. It only talks about the tools, but I think it's very important to know first, where are we going? And then you think about how do we get there? And then we have to talk about the different tools. But just to say, okay, we have the tools, it's basically, okay, do you want to take the car, the bike, the train, or the plane, but we don't know whether we're going to Hamburg or to Munich. And that's, I think, not super useful. I think what we really need is a change of policies in the European Union. I'm sure you talked about that a lot. And then he just comes with institutions, and the only policy options that he offers, for example, if we look at scenario five, you know, more Europe, so lots of Greens will say, yeah, that sounds reasonable. But then he puts something in that more Europe means more trade agreements. And then those Greens would usually say, yeah, more sounds good, but more trade agreements, maybe not. So I think it's really important that we first know which way to go. And then about this multi-speech Europe, I really have a problem with that. Because, of course, indeed it exists. We have the Schengen countries, the Eurozone countries. We have the enhanced cooperation already now. So there is an institutional possibilities for member states to move ahead together. We had that, for example, when it comes to binational marriages of homosexual couples. So some countries said, no, we don't want to because we don't have that issue, basically. They don't allow, we don't do this, basically. And then others says, but okay, we have a problem, you know, people marry and they get divorced and have children, whatever. So this is perfectly possible, and it's possible within our framework. So it was always inside the European Union lawmaking. So the Parliament was involved, and it still is, and everyone else was involved. And then when more countries would join, the idea that, you know, people could love each other no matter what sex they are, they could simply join this procedure. But I'm very afraid that when Merkel and others are talking about two-speech or multi-speech Europe, they talk about something else. They talk about, you know, the Northern Eurozone thing. They talk about leaving Eastern Europe aside. And I think that's very worrying. So while I actually think that in a lot of cases it makes sense that some member states go ahead, for example, refugees, easily, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever number of member states could say, okay, we go ahead and resettlement, for example. We host more refugees than we would have to under any relocation scheme or whatever. Curiously, this doesn't happen. It never happens, you know, in all these good places. And that's why I'm very skeptical when I hear it, that it's actually a tool to leave some other countries out. And I don't want that. So while I'm in favor of the enhanced cooperation and of having more and better use of it, I'm not in favor of splitting up the European Union. I'm not in favor of leaving the periphery behind. I'm not in favor of creating, you know, exclusive clubs for stronger countries, whatever that means.
Danke für das klare Statement. Meine Frage, ich möchte gerne hier.
Thank you for this wonderful statement. My question. Aren't you turning in circles here? Because if you and your colleagues say, first of all, there needs to be political change, a political transformation. First of all, we need to agree on what we want, content-wise, and then we adjust the institutions. But that's the problem, because it's impossible to agree on anything with the institutions whilst by opening towards coalitions of the willing and others. I mean, it will be a patchwork at the end, politically spoken, but there is at least an opportunity for the like-minded member states to travel along.
Decision-making is very difficult at the moment because of the member states, by the way, and the European Council is, you know, not something that you would necessarily need. What you have is the Commission that makes proposals, you have the Parliament and the Council, like the ministers of the member states meeting and doing that legislation. Why do you have to move everything to the European Council? Why do you have to move everything to the intergovernmental point? You know, where heads of state and government are the only ones who make decisions, like we see in the EU-Turkey deal. It's only a deal between member states and Turkey. Oh, by the way, it's also not a deal, but that's a different story. So I'm not sure that like the currently existing institutions are so much the problem. We want to change them as well. You know, I mean, I'm not saying we don't need to have reforms. Obviously we do, but you need to be sure where you want to go. For example, when you say We want that the European Union does something to control globalization. Plus ou moins, like to say, okay, it's a big issue, we have to do something about it. That does not include yet everyone agreeing what that means. Because of course we have also different political parties who represent different, you know, a different electorate, and that's very important. I don't want us to become a monolith of where everybody has to have the same. Well, okay, I wouldn't mind that so much. But maybe that wouldn't happen, to have a big green party, he suggests. But it's important to understand which are the areas where we need to focus, which areas can we bring the EU closer to citizens, how do we deal with people's expectations? Do we ask people for what expectations they have? Rather than to say, okay, do we want 2 speeds, 3 speeds, 4 speeds, less, more, different, more efficient? What does it mean to be more efficient? In the current legislation, being more efficient usually means have less environmental legislation. Whether that's efficient, I'm not so sure. So that's why I really think it's important to know where you're going. And then you have to adjust the tools. For example, also in the scenario for more Europe, it just says something like, of course, I don't know by heart yet, have to reform the Eurozone governments. That can mean a lot of things as well. It really depends what do you want to do with that common currency. Do you really want to have a common economic and currency zone? And it's very difficult to say, first we decide the tool and then we decide the direction. I really don't think that's the good way forward.
Ja, vielen Dank. Ondřej,
Ondřej Liška is the third participant not born in the EU. He is from the Czech Republic. And at the age of 17 already, he founded an NGO there. And at an early age, he became the Minister for Youth and Education. That was in 2007. He was a member of parliament in the Czech Republic, and right now he's the director of Ashoka Austria in Vienna. Almost too. I'm just reading your CV. In charge of Central and Eastern Europe. So he's, so to speak, the country director for many countries, not only in charge of Austria, that is. Good. We've heard about the reception of different proposals, Juncker, and the enthusiastic decision for one model or the other. We are dealing with the political vacuum of these approaches or ideas. We don't quite know what they mean. But the question is, what can be done in order to connect with the people? How do we manage to not only have an empty bureaucracy talk, but that people understand what it's all about?
It's great to be again here, and quo vadis. I believe I totally subscribe to what Ska said, and I would like to come back to that again on the multi-speed Europe. I think I would like to mention maybe a Central European perspective on that, if you allow me. Maybe before I answer a question, first thing, I would just add another point or two or three. First, I think that if we go for the scenario on multi-speed Europe, which we already actually are at, it's a open leaving out of people within those societies that will not make it to the best club, to the five-star club. Young people, civil society, to leave them up to the local political elites that are actually reviving the nationalist discourse at the moment across Central and Eastern Europe. And the second point is, we would also get rid of, or let's say resonate on, the transformative power of the European integration. Because what brought us, like really qualitatively, I don't know how many steps forward, was the Europeanization of the politics through the accession, was actually something that brought the societies really pretty much forward. If we just don't do this anymore, if we say just stay where you are, we will only a few will qualify for a special club. That would also actually, we would leave this transformative power of European integration. And the third, I would say, is that every community or society or even a state lives out of an idea. It's always based on an idea. Sometime before it was, we are all German, now we are all citizens under German constitution. Or there was the idea of Czechoslovakia. There was an idea too, although there were three separate nations. Actually, this Czechoslovak, or the idea of the Czechoslovak nation, was born to outnumber the Germans, where there were more of them than Slovaks at that time. So we were Czechoslovaks, although now being Slovak in Czech Republic and or Czech is no question. Or you have a society that lives out of an idea of rights or privileges or values. And I think the EU has for decades lived out of that idea. It was born out of the World War, we all know that. But it became slightly technocratic. And now people are being asked to still believe in that idea, still be loyal to that. But for most of the society, it's actually non-transparent how things work out. I mean, I bet we all know how things work, more or less, how decision-making process is being done. But for a large portion of people, especially in the accession states of 2004, still the public discourse on Europe is much more lagging behind. I mean, if you ask people what they understand under European policy, for them, it's Europe definitely not a dimension or space for action. It's not. So what we really need, and no wonder...
What is it?
Yes. Well, what we like, I just skip a bit forward, we really need to rethink the civic education. I mean, this is a... I would say this is a... no wonder former minister is going to say that, but I really believe this. I think that in most European countries, you don't find a decent, a complex curriculum that would integrate citizenship or civic, democratic citizenship in all parts of the curriculum. Well, in Germany, you're very privileged. You have this politische Zentrale für politische Bildung. You have nothing like that in most of the countries. And you have especially nothing like that in Czech Republic, Hungary, etc. So where
maybe
the idea...
Maybe it's good that we don't have it in Hungary today.
Yes, well, if you don't have that, it's being replaced by a different narrative, and that is nationalistic or xenophobe or populist, whatever. So what I really like to plea for is to rethink education in terms of active citizenship. And only if we are able to show that not only local level of politics or the national level of politics, but a European level of politics is a space of potential action, of individual civic action, then we can revive that idea. And I think that is another reason why we should not go for scenarios like multi-speed and whatever, that we should go to the roots and not to use a technocratic solution. Because all, I would say most of the scenarios that has been depicted by Juncker are actually technocratic, as Ka said. And they really don't address the real problem why European, I would say, passion or spirit or idea among the largest portion of the population is not that popular anymore. And one last thing I want to add at the beginning is that, for example, I mean, again, an example from education, right? Like there was a big discussion in most of the countries, but let's pick Czechia. Why can't we have a Finnish educational system in the Czech Republic? Why can't we have these great achievements, even if we copy-paste? And the problem, after all, is that we don't have enough Finnish people in the Czech Republic. Because you need Finnish people to have a Finnish educational system. So you can't copy-paste political culture. You can't copy-paste just political structures and expect that will, in different contexts, give the same outcome. So you actually, we have 27 European attitudes or approaches, and even in those countries you have several ones hardly comparable. So what we have, what we already acknowledge, that euro and the current, I would say, Germany driven politics of economic politics and austerity is actually not taking into regard the large diversity of economic achievements in the member states. The same way we should think of political cultures in the particular countries. You have a totally different discourse on Europe in Hungary, as we all know, but you also have in other countries. So what we need is to actually debate, although we know that in, for example, education, we don't have any acquis, there is no common ground for that, but a debate about what it means to be European. I mean, why there is no wonder that Erasmus is being always put forward as the most successful program. And I think initiatives like this one we've seen today, the Pulse of Europe, are great because they're bringing back the passion. At the same time, I think it needs to be systemic. It's nice to overcome, or it's important to overcome hard times like we are facing now. But I think we have to, if you want to make it sustainable, then it shouldn't be a privilege of people in developed democracies in Europe that know already and go and show it, but it has to be a standard transformative experience of every child to learn from very on that it's a citizen that is able to act on local, national and European level and give those instruments into their hands.
Danke. Es gibt ein Problem.
Thank you. Political education, or education in general, is a problem. Education is a long-term project. And I mean, even if you go and subscribe to what you've just said, European education at schools, in the curricula, and so on, well, that's a good idea. But this is a project which will trigger the first results in 10 or 15 years only. However, we are dealing with crises today, and we need to deal with them today. And there are certain requirements, for example, with respect to decisions that need to be made unanimously, whereas the countries, the member states, are blocking each other. So you are against the multi-speed Europe. How do you get out of the dilemma? It's difficult. Indeed. I mean, this is the end of the day. We are the last panel, and you expect solutions from us. And I'm afraid we can't offer solutions either. But there is a kind of answer, i.e., we should not accept the way the debate is held or is offered. I mean, the Green Party is a member of the European Parliament, and I hope there are other enlightened forces there too. Unfortunately, today, the foreign minister of the Czech Republic argued against the free movement of people, which is a true revolution, so to speak, after 20 or 25 years of policy in the Czech Republic before and after the accession, where people asked for an opening, and now they are closing down, so to speak. So darker times are ahead of us in Europe. What can be done concretely? Now, if you ask me, people need to understand that major parts of Europe, and in countries where people are very aware of their identities and which are threatened by darker times, that we, together with you, with Western Europe, and those who are in favor of the multiple speed Europe, go and say, please don't. Because we need to ask, what can we do in order to bring Europe forward together? What are the tools we can use? What can be done in order to support this fragile alliance of political thinkers in Europe, across the border and borders and beyond boundaries that's actually the right approach. However, I'm afraid that this is not going to happen, because we are going to have a first class and a second class coach. So we need to be much more forward going. I think the Dutch success, the Netherlands and other examples in Europe show that apparently we have not yet hit the right note. We cannot offer a tangible vision of Europe. We have not been capable of showing such a vision. I mean, the Green Party has been lobbying for the Green New Deal for 10 years, if I'm not mistaken. But you don't hear anything about it. I mean, you go and talk about it time and again, and the debate within the Green Party is a very advanced one, but it doesn't reach the people. So let's look at the Netherlands and other countries. Look at what is happening there in order to see the connections and in order to understand what needs to happen in order to have people react positively in view of Europe. I think if you trigger the passion of people, it works. Shada, your passionate vision has just been torn down, right? What do you tell us? I mean, what's your comment?
Torn down, no, but reinforced. I don't think that we are changing the goalposts. We're not changing the scale. We're not changing the ultimate goal of Europe, which is peace, prosperity, diversity. What we're changing is the speed at which we reach that. And I think that's being realistic. I think the big credit that I would give to this white paper is that it stimulated discussion. Because a lot of us have said up to now, you know, we're just sort of going round and round in circles. There are no new ideas out there. We need a new narrative for Europe. You know, where's that going to come from? And what I appreciate in this, as I said, it's not my best. I mean, it's not the best effort. It's B for effort, if you like, B plus perhaps, is that it is stimulating a discussion. The goalposts are not changing. The process has begun. And I think that's where what you've said, Ondřej and Scott, that's where we bring in our ideas, because the consultation, the conversation is there. And what has been missing in Europe has been this conversation. Now, I think Brexit actually triggered the biggest conversation we've had, the liveliest conversation we've had about what is Europe and what it means to be European. And I think, of course, it could have been a much more enigmatic, charismatic vision put forward, but are we ready for that? We're not. We need to have a discussion. And in a democracy, that's what consultations are about. So if I look, I'm not a spokesperson for Juncker, God forbid, you know, but the fact is that we are talking about it, and the discussion will continue for 2 years. And during those 2 years, there will be elections everywhere. I mean, we've got France coming up, Germany, and others. This will be an element of that discussion. And I think that is something very, very useful. Now, with the European Parliament elections coming up, that's when crunch time comes. That's when decisions will have to be taken. And then, who elects the Parliament? We do. So that's where our responsibility as citizens comes in. You know, we can't just wait for the European Commission, God bless its soul, to send us messages to keep us happy and reassured. We need to work for this Europe. This is our Europe. This is what, you know, Alexander has shown as well. People are out there in the streets, in the cold rain. I was there yesterday, by the way, and it is very moving. It's what Europe is about. And I think that's where the discussion has to go now. And I don't think we're creating separate coaches. The thing is, those who want to join, and that will mean you guys, civil society in this society, in these countries, pushing your government to that goal. I think it creates an impetus into what has become, I think you'll agree, a very stagnant debate. We were self-criticizing, we were self-flagellating, we are bad. I mean, Juncker had talked about a collective depression. You listen to anything Donald Tusk says, it's so sad, Europe is depressing, you know, we have a collective this then, an existential crisis. Well, guys, you know, live in India and see what an existential crisis is all about, you know, go figure, you know. So I think that's the big, for me, I have to say, sorry, for me, what I have to say is really it energizes what has become a rather putrid discussion. And I think that's where people like us have to actually take up the challenge and make it into a something that actually pushes the whole machine forward, not just the engine, you know? But that's our responsibility. We can't expect miracles from the European Commission. We just can't.
Shada, you are our engine. You are the engine. And I don't mean to kill the sparks that you're producing, but I want to come to a technical question nevertheless. Wenn wir, du kannst trotzdem dich austoben. Wenn
we look at these five scenarios, model through, differentiation, member states having opt-in, opt-out options. Why is that necessary? It is necessary because in many countries, assume they are democratic, that the results of national democratic vote is not always unified. If we continue in nationalization, that this is the democratic thing about Europe, then we have a conflict as regards definition of how democracy is perceived nation state wise. We say no, we'll stick to our guns and we'll have no differentiation. I'm not quite sure whether I got your question, actually. We don't have unanimity, for example. There's majority voting here and there. All of a sudden there's majority vote, then there's chaos. No need of unanimity was not helpful, for example, in the area of allocation of refugees. The minority said no. Majority said yes. Actually, everybody has to abide by it. It's a majority resolution. It was not working. So we talk in nation states only, then we won't make any progress. So the risk of divided Europe, you know, core Europe, peripheral Europe, I think this is a real risk. European Union has achieved a lot. It's wonderful. We have what we have. But I'd rather look at these scenarios and okay, now the debate has started. A debate has started about these multiple speeds. That is the focus. Nothing else is debated about. And that's like with these privileged partnerships. You never know what's behind it, what's in it, but you have the feeling there's nothing good in it. Looking at the people that have submitted these proposals, so it isn't instill any optimism as regards to the future, and it's not said which is the direction. Why not about enhanced cooperation? Why not pursue this? We already have that. So what do you want to leave behind? Who do you want to leave behind? And if we look at the refugee crisis, for example, that's not just so such that there are some countries which are the shining role model with a halo and the rest sits in the dark. No, the federal government has ignored solidarity, and that's why we and a problem. And also regarding Nord Stream vis-à-vis Poland, that was not very solidarian. So okay, you can say, look, okay, they can't follow suit. Let's have them in some corner and stay there. So my idea of a joint house Europe is that we focus on on united in diversity and use the tools for strengths and cooperation, and not the headline for a new Europe is everybody do their own stuff. That's not what I want. And of course, case by case, it may make sense. But the headline for the next 30 years, everybody's do their own stuff, this is not good. I don't want this. Can I pass that question on to you? Yeah, Ondřej. mentioned an effectivity, efficiency problem, and there's a legitimacy problem. On efficiency, she said that, but on legitimacy, if we take your approach and use education and explain to people what's European, how European institutions work, this enlightenment offensive, so to speak, that'll take some time. But until which time we take the right to decide for these people what's best for them. That's the quintessence, is it? Isn't it exactly what the populists are warning against? Look, you have these Prague elites or the city elites decide, ignoring the interests of their own population, because the population actually wants something different. Maybe they don't want that, what they are suggesting there, the elites.
Questions, right?
Danke.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, that's true. I know that the proposal with a sort of civic education or civic agency, how if you call it, or democratic citizenship. I know it's all long term, whatever. But anyway, we should really focus on that now. Exactly because it's. Bears fruits only later on, right? And it could be much worse in the future. And the second question that comes to my mind when you ask that is maybe to ask ourselves, like, if we would you democratize radically the EU decision-making process if you knew that one of the scenarios that would come out of that is a total split or auseinanderfallen of the whole EU. I would say, if you ask that and you say yes, then let's go for it, for all it takes. And if you say, no, I better don't, because it's so precious what we already achieved now, then let's durchwursteln. Yeah, let's stick with what we do at the moment, actually, what the EU has been doing actually for decades. So, And if we say yes, we really are democracy and participation is for us as a principle actually much more than EU, although it has achieved a lot. Then let's go for radical solutions, or at least push for them, showcase them, implement them on local levels, push them further. I don't know. I mean, one of the things that maybe if you compare the societies in the EU, not according to GDP or whatever, but in terms of trust that is felt in the societies, then you get a very interesting map, because the amount of trust that is felt in the society in Denmark, in Finland, in Germany, is much higher than you get in the so-called new member states, the accession 2004. Why is that? So shouldn't we actually address trust as a political problem? Now, how to bring back trust? I mean, in almost any democracy, you would say trust is a problem because the legitimation of the state is failing, etc. But there are differences, and the big ones. So currently, I mean, I left politics, active politics, 3 years ago. But what I feel is that actually what social entrepreneurs or social innovators and the civil society initiatives are bringing back to the political space, and what's lacking is actually trust. They might do things that are very different. It could be making people participate who are seen as handicapped, or it could be some transparency initiative, or whatever you take. But at the very horizon of any of those initiatives, actually building up trust among people within the society. I don't have a recipe for that, but I think we should rethink that and see it as a political problem, because without that, you are not able, only societies with a higher trust among themselves or among the I would say members of the society are able to build up complex political structures. So lacking the trust actually excludes building anything like that. So I would say, why don't we look at our initiatives and our political actions from that perspective as well?
Vielen Dank. Jetzt machen wir uns.
Now let's honor our promise and open the floor for questions. So questions are welcome. And don't ask us why we have no populists here on the panel. I really enjoyed my role as a populist on the panel. So that's
much interrelated. The first one on education. Education is a national competence. So if we do not have what you mentioned, it is responsibility of national governments or the EU. The second one is about trust. I think it's very key. But the problem that you mentioned, again, I think it's very much linked to the national member states. Because the fall in trust that we are experiencing, it's true, it's relative to the EU institutions, but even more, especially in peripheral countries, relative to the domestic governments. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I'm just trying to see where the responsibilities lies and what we can do.
Mm-hmm. Ondřej, would you like to respond right away?
Yes, of course, education is a national thing, but why I mentioned it was actually a call for action on a national level or in a level of the member states for the civil society and politics. I mean, the conversation about education in global terms is like peaking. It's not only civic education, it's like, why are we, our kids are still sitting at schools, they look exactly the same like 200 years ago, you know, why is that? You know, can we move forward with our policies and even the EU and global politics if we still educated like 200 years ago? I mean, the content changed, but the relation within that is changing very slowly or not at all in global terms. So that's one thing. The second thing is I think it's in the interest of all democratic parties to actually support civic education, but not all of them are aware of that. I mean, if you look at, I know like the situation in Romania, Hungary, Poland, Slovakia, Czech Republic, I mean, it's totally out of their interest at the moment because they think they don't need it. But if you see how the political discourse, for example, or the scene changed within past 5 years in the Czech Republic, I mean, from a traditional landscape of parties that usually have a pre-war history, and suddenly the strongest party is an oligarch of Ukrainian-Russian style, right? Basically being owner of most read print media, some TV stations, etc., actually controlling himself as a minister of financing, etc. I don't want to go into that. This was a radical change within 5 years. So even now, the more traditional, I would say, political parties on the right and left, they see, okay, what can we do? Maybe we will die out. We never thought of that like 5 years ago. So I think it's also in their interest. So I think there's a space to push for. There's an opportunity window where society could fight that. And then the second thing you have asked was the trust. Of course, I tell you, maybe I answer with an example. The history about refugees in the Czech Republic is huge. It's bigger, the fewer refugees are there, right? So there are almost no, but the hysteria is much bigger than in Germany or any other country that actually took the most of them. And the argument of people who were resistant and very anti migrant, etc., they were always saying to those Gutmenschen, wie ich und andere, yeah, they were saying like, now, okay, it's fine, but take one of them to your home, right? And meaning one would never do it. And then when the media started to actually picture people from Germany who were taking actually refugees home, people were like, my God, they're doing it. I mean, so this was a moment when trust, actually somebody showed trust and led by example and totally changed the discourse. So I'm not saying this is a universal thing, but on that example, I could feel that actually little things can change a lot, even in a big media space, in a media scale.
Yeah, because on this education, sure, it's a national competence, and in Germany, it's not even a national competence. But I think that, you know, we can't just say, okay, it's not a competence, you know, let's leave it in the cupboard, because in every, almost every member state, you have that big problem with populism, right-wing nationalism, and the way how you act against this is also by putting a lot of effort into your education system. And I think it's not acceptable that the European Union basically doesn't appear at all in our schools. Like, I went to school inside the European Union back then, and I learned a lot about how the US votes their president, you know, and this whole system in here and there, and in Congress and Senate, and I don't know what, and it was very complicated. It still is. But I learned nothing about how European Parliament election works. I learned nothing about European history, and apart from ancient Greeks and stuff. But that's not really European history. And I think that is something where really all member states should have an interest in putting that into their curricula, saying, let's at least, you know, have people know how they vote for things, or, you know, what the difference is between the European Council, the Council, and the Council of Europe. I mean, there we would have a good start, right? And I think trust you also built by having people who are able to influence things and being able to have a say. And for that, the European level can also do things like we have the European Citizens Initiative. It's a great start. It's not the end of the story yet, but hey. And voting for people that actually do things then in the parliament. I think with that sort of thing, you actually can also build trust while keeping out the member states, because they don't have to necessarily get involved into everything, even though I think it's absolutely important to do stuff like that also on the local, national, regional level.
So the two questions on education, I agree with you totally. I think, you know, our educational system, my kids went to school in Brussels, and there's hardly any reference to the EU and to Europe and European history. But there's no mention of minorities either. I mean, there's no mention of Islam and the way Islam flourished in Europe. No mention at all. There's no mention of women. I mean, seriously, there is a shortage of references to women in our history books as well. So history is male, pale, and stale, you know? And that has to change. Our history has to become exciting also for people. So I totally agree with you. On the question of trust, I do have a recipe for trust, for building trust. Stop lying. I mean, you know, we live in a post-fact, post-truth world. Brexit has been maneuvered, manipulated on the basis of lies. I mean, guys, there were lies. That bus with the, you know, the money going back, etc., lies. And what happens the next day? These politicians run away to become consultants earning millions of pounds sterling, right? And this is what our politicians are doing across Europe. People lie. I think you're lucky in Germany because you don't have that kind of politician apart from AfD. Well, you know, I mean, Angela Merkel, I have to say, stands up for certain values, and I appreciate that very much in these dark days elsewhere. But our politicians, I mean, it used to be the case in the third world. You know, when Trump became president of the US, you saw all the articles being written, but he's the first African president because he behaves like an African. He's the first Latin American president because he behaves like a Latin American dictator. The fact is, politicians and the system has lost all credibility. So my advice to you guys is to send credible politicians to the EU. You know, make the European Commission not for failed politicians from member states, but real politicians, men and women, who can stand up for Europe, intervene in national debates, have ideas. At the moment, I mean, we have Frans Timmermans, we have some good commissioners. I'm not saying that's not the case, but let's make it better. You know, let's make it better. Some of the best are leaving us. Kristalina Georgieva has left the European Commission to go work for the World Bank. So there are ways of building trust. It's to show that politicians have a certain degree of genuine, authentic credibility, that they're honest, right? And once again, I come back to the European Parliament elections in 2019. That is an opportunity, guys, to get the right kind of politicians out there.
Okay, but isn't this precisely the argument with which Trump have won and Brexit have won?
Nice.
They basically said the same that you're saying about the mainstream politicians, that they should stop lying. That's how Trump sees themselves. That's how Brexiters sees themselves, as an alternative to the lying mainstream elitist politicians.
But they did that with a complicit media, a media, Breitbart and others in the UK, who were buying into their thing. So once again, media also abdicated. I'm a journalist, a former journalist, abdicated its responsibility. So, you know, yes, you can say they're lying, but the real lies, let's be quite frank, are coming from the populists. The credibility deficit exists in the political world generally.
Yeah, but there is no trust deficit towards them by those people.
No, because everything they say, nobody questions it. We're living in a world where no one questions the populace. Geert Wilders was never once questioned by the Dutch media. Marine Le Pen goes on the BBC and doesn't get the difficult questions. So we are complicit. These guys are not just being made by God. You know, they're not just emerging out of the blue. They are the creations of years and years of letting certain questions go unanswered and turning and saying, oh my God, these are such visionary, charismatic people. They have the answers. And we never ask them, okay, so what are the answers? What will you do? How will you change things? And when you do that, that's when their feet of clay are shown.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now we have to collect the questions because this one was a little bit too long. Please, you were first. No, over there was first. The gentleman.
Vielleicht als Vorschlag und Frage.
I have a proposal and a question. Couldn't we try and make a compromise so Europe at different speeds allows for countries that move faster and others that move slower? But it would be good to not get into a situation in which some countries can start something without the others agreeing, because otherwise a country could go and decide to drop bombs on Libya again whilst the others are still pondering the question. So it's okay to have some countries move faster, but the others need to agree, i.e. we need checks. Yeah, that's an institutional proposal, right? You have talked about education, and I'd like to remind you that we produced a European history book 12 years ago or so, which could be used. So there are lots of didactic materials which can be used, and there are also joint commissions. I mean, this is what populists tend to say, we need to fight the Germans on the basis of these old stories, but we have enough information in order to teach the children differently. It's like in the past when we talked about the third world, as we called it today, young people know sometimes more than the older ones. And in addition to the last remark, there are organizations that I have supported for a long time, Medicines Without Frontiers and Pro Azul, and they don't collaborate with the EU anymore because of the asylum policy. But it would be a pity to stop working together, right? So I'd like to remind you of the need for positive examples. So why don't we have countries like Germany or the Netherlands or Sweden move forward and have them accept a certain number of refugees in order to serve as a positive example? It doesn't have to be the war always. This would be helpful. Okay, another good proposal.
When I was hearing Shada Islam,
the fact that you are describing the European history with a lot of variety, important elements, you were claiming your love for Europe. And at the same time, when we talk and debate about Europe, we get the impression that we are surrounded with procedures and institutions. So, and listening to Ska Keller talking about objectives and the fact that we are not courageous enough to think about objectives, but we are just talking about tools, I wanted to ask the three speakers about the way they would write European history, which would interest the whole Europeans. I mean, not a national history, a European history. It might be part, it might be linked to education, but writing this history with who would be your heroes if you had to talk about European heroes?
Okay, wir nehmen noch drei Fragen und danach machen wir.
Three more questions and then there will be a final round up here on the panel. Or four more questions and a concluding round. This week, we're celebrating the 60th anniversary of the Treaties of Rome. And at the same time, we get the Brexit application. Brexit is a lose-lose situation, which is new in Europe. Now, in order to not get depressed, we need to go and say, the EU of the 27 must act together again. There are those who say the EU doesn't deliver, or it delivers too late, or not enough. Right. I mean, the question is, what is the right answer? The white paper, of course, asks more questions, makes proposals, but it's not an institutional concept. And we'll realize that the different scenarios also include different ideas. Europe, the multi-speed Europe, is, according to Mrs. Merkel, parliamentary collaboration in different fields. The approach of the Union, so to speak, of the CDU, that's what the multi-speed Europe is for her. But other interpretations are feasible, and we can also go and say the treaty is good, the basis, the foundation is good, and we now need to combine the basis, and we need to check where the treaty is not sufficient, for example, the European Unemployment Insurance. And these questions or deficits need to be tackled in order to be capable of progression, so we can combine different models. The young men with a tie, I'm not objecting to ties, that is. And please be brief, otherwise we'll run over time. I haven't read the white paper. But irrespective of the question whether you want to focus on institutional matters or politics and contents, I wonder what would a procedure look like in order to begin changing the EU at all. I'm not sure what a new foundation of the EU would bring change, especially with respect to the acquis. I wonder whether the control exercised by the Commission and also by the Court of Justice is not going much too far. So the new beginning, a completely new beginning, would be a solution.
That feel Europeans, real Europeans. This is the youngsters. They're born somewhere. They travel around. They study somewhere and they work somewhere. But how we can get on board these people? Because usually they don't vote, and in some countries they don't have the right to vote when they are outside of the country, like in Greece, for example. And the second group is the refugees, because they love to come to Europe. And it's the people they want to enter Europe. Eh? And we have not realized what means this from dreaming. They have the dream of Europe, but they don't have voice in our societies. And this is a second question. How we can get these groups on board when we discuss about Europe? This is difficult because they don't vote. They don't have right to vote. So.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Eine sehr, sehr gute Frage. Und die letzte Frage, ganz kurz, bitte der Herr in der dritten Reihe. Aber wirklich kurz. Ja,
ja, man sollte sehen, dass
you should try and implement a shared resource and energy policy in Europe. That's what we should try. And we should also carry out occupational policy, labor policy, reduce unemployment. Thank you for these two concrete remarks. Now let's get back to the panel. And all of you who feel addressed can react or may react. There was a question about how to explain Europe in the textbooks. Who are the heroes? I mean, this is probably the question about the European narrative. And then there was a question about the procedure. Wouldn't it be easier to start from scratch instead of transformation, a new beginning? And then a question about the most passionate Europeans, young people and refugees who cannot participate today. And then maybe also concerning the harmonized occupational and energy policy. Is it realistic to achieve a joint approach here? Right, it's over to you. Maybe Shada first.
Thank you very much, Sergey. So for the question of who are my heroes, I don't have a hero. I have the idea as a hero. And I was born in South Asia. Pakistan and India, I was born in Pakistan. Pakistan and India are on a perpetual state of war with each other. It's either a cold war or a hot war. And having been, you know, till I was 18, more or less living in that environment, I realized the power of your reconciliation that has happened in Europe. And now I travel across Asia, across Africa all the time. And the first thing, people, you know, sometimes ridicule Europe and they follow the news, and so they know all our weaknesses, they know all our deficits. But they also still, and I can tell you this really put my heart, my hand in fire and tell you, they still admire the inspiration behind Europe. And I think that is the normative soft power that we have that I think is still relevant and still credible. So I would say, I don't know, I won't name names, but the idea of Europe, and you know, in a world now, we are just, you know, miles away from Aleppo. We see the war, we see the refugees coming here. You know, let's not be complacent. Peace cannot be taken for granted. And I think that is, for me, the ideal of Europe that I will admire, I think, till I die. New beginning, scratch everything and start again. We don't have time for that. We live in a world that is changing so rapidly. New threats, new challenges come all the time from different angles. We non-traditional security threats as well as the traditional threats. We don't have time to have a new beginning, I'm afraid. So we have to deal with the hand we've been played. And it's not a bad hand, as I've said. So I think we need to restructure, reform, change, tweak. But we don't have time to scrap everything and go on. And I totally agree with you, sir, that the real people who believe in Europe today are the young. We've seen that. And you said refugees. I would add minorities as well. I think that is the strength of Europe today. And these are the stakeholders that we haven't reached out to. So I think for the young Europeans, Obviously, we'll have to use new methods, social methods, the internet. I've never understood why we can't use the internet for elections in this 21st century. Things are moving forward. And for refugees and minorities, I think it's an essential tool of integration, is to be a voter, is to be a citizen. Let's start perhaps at the municipal level and work upwards, you know, if it can't be done immediately on a national level. But I think those are the kinds of ideas that I find actually very energizing, because they're out there now and people are talking about it. You know, in town halls, in schools, in universities, in squares across Europe, we're talking about these things. You know, 6 months ago, as Andrew said this morning, people yawned at the mention of Europe. We don't yawn anymore. We're excited about it. So I think we've been galvanized. I think in a sense, Brexit, and I hate to say this, Trump, have actually been gifts to us. They've woken us up from our slumber, from our sense of complacency, and you know, things will always stay the same. So thank you. Thank you for waking us up.
I love this woman. Shada Islam. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Ondřej, could you pick some?
I would like to connect two or three of them, your comments or questions, the heroes, the textbooks, etc. I believe that we are very far from having a textbook on European history, a single one in whole Europe. I think it wouldn't be even good, because there is an example of the French-German textbook. I know there is a German-Polish committee, there is also a German-Czech committee, etc. And no, I think the experience with that is ambiguous. I mean, it was a particular success, but not always, and there are different difficulties around it as well. And I strongly believe that what we should think first before we come to books that are sometimes perceived as actually top-down approach to impose narratives on people, I think we should start with opening up schools to the reality of the current world. I mean, in Germany, you are forced to, because the world is coming into your schools. I mean, the children of refugees are here, so they are confronted, but you have very homogeneous societies, again, in the Central and Eastern Europe, where basically you hardly meet a Roma child, although there is a huge group of Roma people in the society, because all these children are segregated in special schools still in the 21st century. So, I mean, it's changing, but not in the pace that we would wish to. So I think we should, the civil society and the political party should really force the schools to open up and become part of the world that is around that. And I think the heroes should be those who are understandable, tangible for the children. I mean, there are plenty of them, and there are in every single culture and a society, there are Grenzgängers, there are people who actually integrate multiple identities and multiple cultures, and this is the most unique thing about European heritage, and they should be shown and lived and showcased in the schools, right?
Angelika, vielen Dank auch, dass du da bist. Sehr spannend. Ska.
Yep. Warum gehen wir nicht weiter? Hatte ich anfangs schon erwähnt. Ich glaube, da würde es total Sinn machen.
Und I think why refugees would make sense. And one single member says, could say, yeah, let's continue. Will we take more refugees for a resettlement program, humanitarian visa? Two, three, four could join forces and say, look, these 160,000 from Greece, Italy, we'll take them. And we'll not be waiting for Poland, Czech Republic, etc. We'll do that ourselves. But it's not happening. That's why I ask, where do we want to, where are we heading towards with these multiple speeds? It never happens when you can do a good thing. So that's why I'm not too optimistic about the multiple speeds.
So much, but I think it would already help a lot if we learned more about what other countries have as history, that we're not just, you know, learning, in my case, how the Germans, you know, what kings they had, and then this happened, and then this happened, and they had borders, they had no borders, they had borders somewhere else, and then they moved backwards, and so on. But to look at how things developed overall in the whole of Europe, I think that would already be very helpful. For example, I never heard about the Ottoman Empire in my school either. I don't know if I was in a particular school, I wouldn't say so. but stuff like that completely missing from history lessons. Sorry fürs Rumgeswitche, aber
sorry, so switching back and forth between the various different languages, English and German. The best commissioner we've always had in Europe, and I can only agree, on the basis of the existing agreements, you can do a lot. We looked at it on the European for Euro. There's lots happening also on the basis of these agreements. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. You can do quite a lot already now. But long term, you would also need to check what needs to be changed in the agreements. But you don't need the huge revolution in order to do things better. That brings me to the procedure. Of course, we don't know currently where the journey is heading us towards, not about procedure, red bicycle, blue bicycle, Hamburg, Munich. But I don't think we need that drastic restart. I'm always angry when the left say, wow, you neoliberal bullshit, we have to get rid of this existing EU and then we build the new one, which will be great. I don't know whether political majorities have changed during that time. And that's what it's about. I completely agree with Shada. Elections matter. If we have things where people say, okay, we agreed with the monetary policy and with the extradition policy, etc., it's a question of political majorities. And here we need to tackle this problem. We cannot just simply kill this current institution and think let's do a completely new stuff and believe that that this is going to be groovy then.
More and more people have started to realize, oh shit, this is really real and I really have to do something about, like Brexit, for example. You know, I think I was also part of them thinking, yeah, it can't get so bad, you know, oh, it's going to be fine. We're like this. We all went to sleep like this. And then in the morning, we're all like, and then next thing, Trump as well, you know, nah, it can't be so bad and everything's going to be all right. And it wasn't. And I think people are starting to realize that in order for things to be okay-ish, at least you have to do something and at least go and put your thing on the ballot paper, but also, for example, go on the street, go for these demonstrations, go for your local refugee welcome team, whatever. And I think this has been more and more widespread now. People are realizing that, I mean, including, you know, people like you and me. I think part of that was also the high turnout in the Netherlands. I mean, it was so, like, I think it was the highest ever, or at least it was very, very high. And I think it's because people are realizing that they really have to do something about that. But I hope that the results from the Netherlands doesn't bring people back into this, okay, it's going to be all right thing. Because the French elections, that's different, and it might very much not be all right. And on the refugees, I also agree. Like, it's amazing always that you get the best European spirit outside of the European Union, like, be it, for example, in Ukraine, when people went to the streets with the EU flag, when people elsewhere see the European Union as something to aspire to. We know refugees coming and thinking, well, I thought the European Union was a space of the rule of law, of human rights and things, and then they're disappointed. So I absolutely think we have to harvest that spirit, that aspiration. And I also very much agree that, yes, indeed, you should be able to vote where you live. That should be the basic rule. And I'm almost done with the questions, but there were still... Ah, yeah, there was the issue... zurück auf Deutsch. Ja, ob Energiepolitik oder Arbeitslosen oder Arbeitspolitik.
Of course, energy policy, labor policy, employment policy is also EU. If you have a nuclear power plant close to your border, and for whatever strange reason, they're always building these nuclear power plants next to a border of another country. So, and then you start thinking. And of course, and also, like coal-fired power plants, if they fire coal, it's no problem. But air pollution will not stop at a border. Water pollution will not stop at a border. So we need a joint action here, in a joint direction. The question regarding the social policies. joint action is also important. If we have a monetary union, we can still come to the illusion that we have a currency, and within that currency we are competing who's got a race for the bottom in terms of the wages, for example, that can't wash. And if there's a promise of prosperity, who? We are the people in Europe, and that has to do a lot to do with austerity policy, employment policy, social policy. So without the need to regulate everything on the European level, I still think that we need to be more serious when it is about direction, about the question what needs to be done on the regional, local, municipal level, so that we have a function in European level. Thanks, Scar. Keller?
Ja, herzlichen Dank für diese Diskussion. Danke auch an...
Thanks to the discussion. Thanks to all of you. One thing I would like to take back, which I asserted at the beginning, that this white paper is so boring. Obviously, this discussion has shown that this is a basis for very interesting discussions. We've done the first step, and now we continue right down to the European election. So, for those of you who will be part of the expert meeting tomorrow, see you tomorrow. Otherwise, have a nice evening.
Thank you.